All right, so hi everyone, and welcome to another amazing Amicus session here today. Hi everyone who's just joining. This is the first time I'm using Instagram Live, so please bear with me. I also have a huge fan next to me, so if it's too loud, give me a shout. I think I'm covering my microphone as well. So I'm not sure if you're joining us live or if you're going to be watching this later on today or anytime in the future. Thank you so much for supporting Amicus and for joining us on this day when we remember Andrew Lee Jones and all the work that Amicus has done, obviously, in the last 30 years, which is a lot. So, hi everyone, I'm Diana. I am the Casework and Operations Manager here at Amicus. I've been involved since January 2020, so just a couple of months before COVID. We had to shut down the office, as most of other places had to do, and so I've been working from my bedroom ever since. The team is obviously amazing. It's probably the best team I've ever worked with. We have met each other very much. I've actually met Anna once. We've just heard from earlier today. We've met once. Other people I've met just a couple of times. But it's such an incredibly supportive team, and we do talk all day, all the time. And I'm just so honored and humbled to be part of the Amicus family, which is amazing. If anyone has any questions at all, just drop them in the chat. I'll do a little monologue here today for the next 15 minutes. But yeah, if anyone wants to join me, give me a shout, or if you have any questions, please do pop them in the comment box at the bottom. So I became involved with Amicus, I think it was 2014. I was back home in Italy at the time. I was studying an undergraduate degree in political science. And one of my professors was heavily involved in the research of death penalty issues and life without parole issues. And so we started working together on my final thesis, which was on mandatory sentencing of juveniles to life without parole. And when I then graduated, I was really so involved in this topic, and I felt like I had uncovered a crazy injustice, and I didn't really want to stop working in this field. So I did a little Google research. I came across this tiny, amazing charity called Amicus, and I realized that they were actually sending people out to the US to work on these cases hands-on. And so I decided that I wanted to do that. But unfortunately, I did not have a law degree, and that is one of the requirements. And so I made this kind of crazy decision to drop everything, leave Italy, move to rainy London, and study the GDL, which is the law conversion course, I'm sure many of you know. And all with this kind of this idea of doing a placement sometime in the future. For some reason, I got sidetracked a little bit for a couple of years, and only remembered that I wanted to do this placement 2 years ago in 2019. I applied. Some sort of miracle way I was accepted, and I was sent out to Baltimore to in Maryland. Shout out to any The Wire fans. It was great, really, really great. I know Anna and Chloe already spoke about US placements just now, and there's going to be a couple of other speakers later on today who will be talking about placements, so I won't be going into too much detail there. But just suffice it to say, it was incredible. I've worked with some really, really amazing people, and it was just such a beautiful experience because everybody was so empathetic. They really cared about their clients, and you could really tell that with every fiber of their being, they treated the clients like they were their friends and their family. And I think it was a beautiful experience, not just professionally but also personally, to see, kind of be involved in this much kindness. So yeah, I stayed there for about 6 months, came back in December, and started waitressing again. And that's when Margot came along on a white horse, and she was actually looking for someone to join the Amicus office, and so she whisked me away, and I weaseled my way into Amicus again, and I've been here ever since. I'm not going anywhere, and that's anyway, so that's all about me. If anyone has any questions, give me a shout. Otherwise, I'll be talking about the casework that Amicus does, as that is what my job here is. So, Jane will have talked about it this morning, that Amicus was kind of created as a fund. And it was created as a fund with an idea of funding people through law school and just making sure that they would get involved in death penalty representation work. That's changed over the years. We're not a fund, even though we do heavily fundraise. And as a little side note, please do donate if you can. The link will be circulated between sessions. If you can, of course, that would be amazing. So what we do nowadays is we engage with people who are already interested in this topic and they want to help people on death row. And so we work with about 20 big law firms. I'm just gonna name drop a couple here. We work with Linklaters, who we'll hear from later today. We work with Evershed Sutherland, Ellen and Overy, Irvin Mitchell, Kirkland and Ellis. We work with Dentons, Milbank, Baker McKenzie. So really, really great and amazing firms who dedicate some of their pro bono hours to Amicus, and they have a lot of attorneys who are really interested in helping out individuals on death row in the US. And so we kind of work with them. We also work with a bit four universities. I work with Cambridge, Leicester, who we'll speak to later today. And so there's a lot of people who are involved. I think recently we were kind of calculating how many people we work with at the time, and it was something like 900 people. At any given time. So the projects we deal with really vary. The first thing that we do usually is just speak to the attorneys and see what they need doing. The work really, really varies. Anna and Chloe have spoken about that earlier today. There's various projects that need to be carried out on death penalty work. And so it does heavily depend on what is needed at any given time throughout the case. We then find the team that is most suited to take on this work, and we brief them, we check the work that they do, make sure that everything's all right before we send it back to the US team. So yeah, what we do really, really varies depending on the case. It could be anything from summarizing trial transcripts to kind of check how the attorneys dealt with certain issues, if they were effective, if they represented the client thoroughly, and so on. We might do mitigation investigations, so either investigating law issues or fact issues. We might be summarizing phone calls. We might be looking at social media records. We might be processing and summarizing other records, and so on. So it does really depend on what the team does. So there's a question here, can individuals get involved in casework too? Yes, they can. So the casework does require quite a bit of management, so we don't have a lot of availability. There's a couple of spots that we do have open throughout the year, so if anyone on this call is actually interested in getting involved in casework, the requirements we do have is that you are an Amicus member, that is because of insurance reasons. And the other requirements is that you have a law degree. This is because we kind of need to have caseworkers working with us who have this analytical skills. And I know that it's not just people in law that do have these skills, but that is the requirement that we have set. So if you are interested at any point, just get in touch with Amicus either via our Instagram or any email address. We will get in touch and see if there's any projects that might be available that we could get you started on. So, great question. Thank you. Right, so why is this important? Each capital case is really, really huge. So you don't just have your basic case facts, which is the basic evidence in the case. You also have, because a capital case is so, well, obviously there's a life on the line. It, as it moves through the systems, you get more and more appeal stages. And at every appeal, usually you have a different attorney representing the client. And so as the case moves through the system, more and more records are created that the attorneys need to kind of look through and analyze and so on. So each case has probably hundreds and hundreds of thousands of documents that need to be reviewed. And there's a serious imbalance in the US in terms of prosecution and defense, in that the prosecution might have unlimited resources. They have million members of staff, where defense usually just has an attorney, a paralegal, an investigator. So the team is quite small, and they are not able to look at all this evidence by themselves. And which this is why Amicus stepping in and taking over some of this work is really, really important and can actually make a huge, huge difference. I know Anna mentioned it earlier today about mitigation, and I don't want to go into too much detail here because we do have mitigation specialists joining us. later today, but I just want to briefly explain why it's important that we focus so much on records, because in capital cases it's not all about the law. The main reason we are able to get people off of death row is because of mitigation. And mitigation is any reason that a jury might decide to spare someone's life and give them a life sentence instead of a death sentence. And so what we do is we investigate a person's life, not just theirs, but also their parents, their great-grandparents, their grandparents, their cousins, their uncles, and so on. And we just try to build a sort of life history and a social history that we can then present to a jury and show them that this is actually a human being, that they have their faults, they have their vulnerabilities, they have their strengths and weaknesses. And those are the things that actually make a jury vote for a life sentence instead. But it does require a lot of investigative work, and that is where the records are really important. Most of individuals on death row are also there because of mental health issues, and that also shows, and the trauma as well also shows itself through memory loss issues. So sometimes they're not able to really help out in their own preparation of the defense, which is why we so heavily rely on records to tell us about them and tell us about their experiences. So records are really, really important that way, especially nowadays where we're talking with, where individuals have social media profiles, they have smartphones, so downloads from there really, really are huge, so they require a lot of investigation. And because the stakes are so high, there is a human life on the line, you really need to be as thorough as possible. So yeah, that's some of the document review that we do. We also do fact-based research. For example, recently we have looked into the school system. One of our clients was, oh, there's a question. No. Oh, yes. Do you get to communicate with people on death row as part of your job? We do not, really. The work we do is really very much separate from the individuals on death row. We don't have that direct communication with them. The work we do is really so remote because we do rely on pro bono volunteers to give us maybe an hour a month. And so we kind of snippet the work into chunk-sized work that they can handle in their own time or whenever they are free. There is not this direct communication with the clients. It's also really, really important to remember that most clients and most individuals on death row are heavily traumatized. They're going through this really, really, really tough time, and having them meet with random strangers who are in and out of their cases sometimes is also not very beneficial to them and their mental health state. And so we do tend to not be involved with them. We might send them some letters throughout the year or send them our journal or communication like that, but we do not communicate to them directly as part of our remote casework project. But that's a really, really good question. Yeah, so that's kind of the work that we do on casework. If you want to see how cases progress, I think the best way to do that is to follow us on social media. Just a little shout out to Katie Lynch, who's not here today, but she does all of our social media. She's our social media manager, and she does a really great job at keeping everyone informed and involved with anything that's going on. So thank you to her. Just keep an eye out on Instagram and Twitter and Facebook if you want to see how our cases move on, but they do tend to take decades and decades as they move through the system, so the work that we do is really not that immediate, and it does take a long time to see any results in the work that we do. Is there another question, or is that the same? What's your favorite thing about being involved with Amicus? I think my favorite thing with being involved with Amicus is probably a super cheesy answer, but it is the team. It's seeing people who are, we all believe the same thing, and we all, I don't know, there's just this really beautiful kindness and empathy and acceptance within this community that I've never really experienced anywhere else. And that was at every stage of this work. That's our volunteers who join us, that's the team members who join us, that's our trustees, that's our supporters, and that's the US teams that we work with, that's our UK caseworkers. It feels like it's such a beautiful community that's really based on kindness and empathy, and it is just incredibly, incredibly beautiful and humbling to be part of this work. I've actually just realized that I've run over time, so I think I will stop it here unless anyone has any questions. Just the last thing I want to mention, if you would like to get involved in casework, just let us know. If your firm you think might be interested in joining us and doing some work for us pro bono as well, just send us an email. We can set up a call with you and your pro bono coordinators and see if any of our projects kind of fit with what you want to get involved in. We do a couple of research studies as well that we'll talk about later on today. We have Hannah joining us to talk about the Florida project, where we kind of monitor all pretrial cases in Florida, pretrial first-degree murder cases, and see which ones get the death penalty, and we monitor as they move through the system. We also will speak to Harrison in the afternoon. He has been heavily involved in the Missouri project, which is kind of similar, but there we look at historical data of which cases actually became first-degree murder cases and which cases ultimately got the death penalty. Right, so another thing I want to mention is that it's not all super happy times all the time. Obviously, we are dealing with death penalty cases, and it, we obviously always strive to ensure that clients get given a life sentence or that they accept a plea. Sometimes we are not so lucky, and Andrew, of course, was one example where things did not go as planned. Amicus as well has been involved in a case for many, many years. Wesley Perkey, who unfortunately was executed last year, was just around this time this week, a year ago. And obviously, there's been so many people involved in his case throughout the years. I would say hundreds and hundreds of volunteers. And we sometimes forget that this work does not only impact the victim of the case and the defendant in the case, but also everybody who's kind of touched by the death penalty in one way or another. And volunteers that work on casework are a big part of that. And I just want to give a little thank you to everyone who's been involved in casework, and in this case in particular. Of course, it was a terrible time for everyone, and I wanted to thank you all for agreeing to participate in that, because that's always an option that we need to keep at the back of our heads. So I will leave it here, because we have another great session coming up, but I wanted to thank every one of you who's joined us today or who will watch this in the future. We have a WhatsApp group that's called the Amicus Army, and I think it started as a joke, but I do think it's true. Every person who's kind of involved with Amicus, be it as a caseworker, a volunteer, or writes for our newsletter, or donates, or just joins us and watches these videos, you're all part of the Amicus Army as well. And thank you so much for your support. I hope you will enjoy the rest of the day.